Everyone, there's tons of seats up here. I know we're a little bit intimidating right up here, but if you need a seat, please come on in. Hi, everyone. This is Missy. I'm Nilou. I don't think this woman really needs introduction. I'm super excited to be here because I get to not only dine at her amazing restaurants, but also be her friend, and she cooks for me sometimes at home. But Missy has had kind of a bananas 2 years, I would say. You opened your own first own restaurant, Lilia, in Williamsburg. If you guys haven't been, good luck getting a reservation. Just and she also wrote a cookbook. She got 3 stars from the New York Times. Thank you for coming up. Here you go. 3 stars from the New York Times. She won a James Beard Award for the best chef in New York City, which is no mean feat. And in the last 2 weeks has opened her second restaurant in the former Domino refinery in Williamsburg called Missy. So I can't even believe you're here. She basically works from 10 in the morning till 2 in the morning. And it's a miracle that we got her here. So thank you.
Thank you.
I want to first ask you, because you made kind of a big shift a few years ago, and you went from working for a big restaurant group, you worked at a Voce, to first of all taking kind of a break, but then also deciding that you were going to be a chef owner. What are the challenges of making that decision?
I think it was a really scary decision, and when I left a Voce, I really left with no plan, and everyone doesn't believe me, and everyone thought I had the secret restaurant project, and I really needed some time and space to really even figure out if I wanted to be a chef and be in a restaurant. And I was it turned out quite burned out, which isn't really why I left a Voce, but I really needed just time. And I think the decision became actually not that challenging. It became kind of easy for me. I realized that I just wanted independence, and I liked working for restaurant groups. I had worked at Spiaggia, which is part of a $800 million company, and it was a very supportive environment, and I did that for 5 years, and I like the stability of being in a company. But I think for me the biggest challenge was finding the right partner. And I searched for a really long time, and I had, in that time that I was off, which ended up between leaving Avoce and opening Lilia, was close to 2.5 years by the time it really opened. But I searched for a long time for the right partner, and I met with all the big restaurateurs, every name that you could name, and I met with random people, and I ended up with my next door neighbor as my partner, who had not previously been in the restaurant business. But what happened was we developed a friendship, and we had the same values, and he really understood what I wanted to do, and he understood kind of my philosophy, and he was passionate, and we had a good time together, and it sort of worked. And we took a really big risk on each other, because when he first asked me and he said, "Hey, I've watched you go through all these meetings, and I want to be your partner," I said, "No, that's actually not going to happen, because you've never opened a restaurant before." And then we kept talking for 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, and finally it just made sense. And it made sense not because he was a restaurateur, but because he was a good person, and a person that I could relate to. And so I think the biggest challenge was, for me, I didn't want to do it alone. And I think a lot of chefs just want to go do their own thing, and they don't even want a business partner. And I wanted someone who had complementary skills to mine that weren't the same. I didn't need another chef in the kitchen with me. I had always thought I wanted a GM as a partner, you know, that front of house person. And he wasn't that either. He was a business person. And I think sometimes you find what you're not looking for. And that was really great for me.
I there's so many things I want to unpack here. So first of all, what were some of those meetings like that you, we've never talked about that. So what were some of those meetings like? It's like you were like Goldilocks. You were trying on all the different options out there to see which one was going to be the right fit.
They were all, I mean, I felt, first of all, very, very lucky. You know, I got to sit in an office with Danny Meyer, and that meeting proved to be extremely important for me, because he said to me in that meeting, and it was sort of more of like, is there something here for me? But it was also just kind of getting advice from someone that I really respect and admire. And he said to me in that meeting, what are you happiest doing? Are you happiest when you hold a pan in your hand? And I said, no, not at all. I'm happiest when I'm planning and mentoring and like developing and doing menu development and being in the kitchen, but not chopping onions all day. And I think that a light bulb sort of went off for me, because I knew really at that point that I probably couldn't work for someone else, and that I needed to kind of be in a more entrepreneurial position where I could still sort of hone my chef skills, but also do everything else that surrounds a restaurant. And what excites me, and we were just talking about this a few minutes ago, like the design aspect and designing a restaurant from head to toe, and the graphic design and everything that goes into a restaurant. The food part for me 25 years later is the easy part. The hard part is everything else that goes along with it, and team building and marketing and PR and all that other stuff is really exciting to me.
And which then you basically said all the skills. You said the food,
skills.
So now what are the complementary skills?
Just don't like spreadsheets.
Spreadsheets, okay. So you basically I think that was like a really, I mean, first of all of us wish that Danny Meyer would take a couple minutes and give us some of his like Danny Meyer like advice, the way he manages.
I don't even think he knows that he gave me, it wasn't
advice. I bet
advice.
You will know by the end of this, maybe.
I wrote about it in the cookbook, but I've said it many times, because it was really an impactful thing for me. I met with Steven Starr, who was wonderful, and he just didn't have the right thing for me at the time. But everyone I met with was really supportive and wonderful. It just was like kind of this ongoing feeling that nothing felt right. And probably at the time that I opened Lily, I was 44, and I had wanted to open a restaurant by the time I was 30. So I was 14 years behind my goal.
But you hadn't been like, you know, Obama was liking your pasta at Spiaggia,
yeah,
so you weren't like resting
like
on your laurels.
Correct. But for me, I had this internal thing, and finally sort of part of what happened was I said, okay, well, if I'm going to open a restaurant, if I'm really going to do this, like if I don't do this now, I'm probably never going to do this, because I would have gotten another job and it would have taken me another 5 years. And even if I had partnered with someone else, it's the idea of partnership is really broad. And I think a lot of times we hear chef partner in a lot of restaurants, and chef partner, you're still kind of working for someone else. You may have a piece of the business, or you may take a percentage or whatever, but you're not necessarily an owner. And I think I wanted real ownership, and it wasn't a financial thing. It was really more of a mental thing of like really investing everything you have into a space and into a staff and into your guests.
And I think that word ownership is such a big deal, because I think it's great when you're getting a big paycheck, but that we can't underestimate how great that is. But the reality of wanting to feel like you are actually shaping something from, you know, from the beginning to the end is very much what you and Sean do. So watching you and Sean at work is pretty amazing, because this guy who's a spreadsheet guy, never run a restaurant, has become quite the front of house dude. And you
He's
are
amazing.
And you are also out there doing all the baby kissing and handshaking and all the stuff that you need to do, and all the media. And you seem to have kind of an amazing collaboration. And since the theme of this day is collaboration, how do you guys make sure that this magical relationship exists? And is it magical? And how do you make sure that you're on the same page? Because it's a little bit like mommy and daddy.
There's a little mommy and daddy thing going on. We do have an incredible relationship, and we set a lot of boundaries from the very beginning. And, you know, some of those things are, you know, very basic communication things, like not going to bed angry, cutting out. I mean, seriously, we're like basically married, and he does have a wife who's very lovely.
And you're the godmother of his.
And I am the godmother of his twin sons as well. So there is a familial aspect to it that I think helps and can also
hinder.
Be challenging. But there is a familial thing. But I think communication is really the key. We very early on, you know, texting, I think, is a wonderful thing in our society now, but it can also be really terrible. We sort of have a rule that when things start to get a little hot in texting, we cut it off. And we just say, like, listen, let's talk about this later. And that takes that takes a lot of awareness to be able to do that, because sometimes you're in the heat of it. We also like to stay in what we call our lanes. And when those lanes start to like intersect, I think we kind of take a moment and say, all right, like you do your thing. And it's not that we're not interested in each other's lanes. Like I'm very interested in the financial health of our business, and I'm very in tune with it, and I look at the spreadsheets every day, but I don't want to create them, and I appreciate that he has, you know, a microscope on them and can hone in on things, and I kind of look at them broader, but he's also someone who's a great networker, and he's someone who wants to go out and meet with people and learn about technology in our industry and learn about real estate in our industry, and I'm interested in all those things, but not to the extent that he is. And I think I'm grateful to have a partner who really wants to do that. So it extends, it's not about sort of the four walls of the restaurants and like what we each do on a nightly basis, because that intersects quite a bit. Someone actually thought that he was a chef last night. Someone was talking to me and they're like, well, who expedites when you're not there, Sean? And I was like, huh? And I was like, no. I'm like, he hangs out in the kitchen a lot, but usually he's making a snack.
Also, you're always there. Yeah, he's always like, he's like having
he's
a little bit of a
usually grilling bread for himself. No, I think it's about having a real understanding of who's doing what, and it's always kind of been understood that I am the creative in the group and that he's the business in the group, and he always says, I'm not creative, but what I've learned is that he is quite creative. He has an incredible marketing mind. So I don't know if anyone's seen our hashtag or our t-shirts that say choose pasta, but that's all Sean, that's not me. Our Instagram is all him. He built the whole Lilia Instagram. He does have like a really creative mind, just in a different way. And I've gotten him very into interior design. He's constantly sending me stuff from Dwell now and things that like
it's he exactly didn't, like
I'm
married.
Not even sure that he knew it existed before. But I think that's pretty cool.
So I really you talked about Instagram and you touched on something that I think is definitely an issue for all of us who are in this industry. You just opened a restaurant like 2 weeks ago, a week ago?
2 weeks ago,
two
yesterday.
Yeah. 2 weeks ago yesterday. Yeah.
Saturday.
What is the most challenging thing to opening a new place in this environment, even though your restaurant was one of the most hotly anticipated? There are literally, when I say literally, there are actually lines out the door when you open, and this is not hyperbole, this is actually what's happening for the last
2 weeks. It's very frightening.
Which is amazing, but what are you waking up in the middle of the night sweating?
You know, I think there's a couple of things. I think on a bigger scale, when I opened Lilia, people knew me and they were sort of curious, like, where did Missy Robbins go and why isn't she cooking anymore and what the hell is she doing opening in Williamsburg? And I think 2.5 years has passed, and for me, there's a lot of internal strife of the anticipation and expectation coming off the James Beard Award and coming off of Lilia, and I think everyone, there's not a lot of time to get it right. And you feel this like pressure to get it right from the minute you open the door, and that's not necessarily realistic. There's a lot of moving parts to the restaurant, and I think getting the right team in place, and we have an incredible team. We have an incredible front of house management, an incredible back of house management, an incredible support staff on every side, like really impressive people. But it doesn't work like a well-oiled machine in 5 days. And so I think in the age of Instagram, like, everyone comes there now and they already want this tomato dish, which was the last dish I came up with the night before we opened.
And somehow I didn't have it when I was there for friends and family, and now I'm mad.
I think you don't get any chance to like work on things and fix things because there's already this expectation the night you open because people start like putting it out there, whether you want them to or not. But on the flip side, there's something really beautiful about that, and to see people so excited and so excited about particular things is motivating also.
And then you get, I mean, immediate gratification for not just you, which I think is great, but I think for your team. And I think one thing I really want to touch on, because I think you work on this really hard, is the culture of the restaurants. So the culture of Lilia, your management style with Sean. So talk us through that.
Yeah, I think you know, I grew up in an age of restaurants that was difficult and challenging and sort of like, this is the way you do it and it's the only way you do it. And, you know, when I left Voce, like I said, I was burnt out, I was stressed out. I didn't always manage the way that I would want to. I was sort of, I don't know, angry might be a good word, but like stressed out. And I wasn't always the best listener. And when I left Voce, like the one reason I really wanted to leave was to kind of work on myself. And that had physical implications and it had mental implications. And when I came to open Lilia, and one of the reasons why Sean and I came together and in those conversations about sharing values, it was about the kind of company we wanted and how we wanted to be with our staff and create sort of this family within our restaurants. And we've worked really hard to do that. And I am just at a point in my life where I'm much mellower than I was before, and taking that time off after 20 years of working without a break at all really, really, really mellowed me out. And I think there's a certain confidence that I think comes with like age and development and understanding management. But I think the culture that we want is one where people are happy and where they can thrive and where they can thrive outside of work and inside of work. And, you know, we really work hard to give people the days off they want. And to, you know, if someone comes to me and they're like, I have 3 weddings this summer, the old me would have been like, tough shit, like you gotta work. And I, in the time that I was off, like I really thought about how many holidays I missed and how many weddings I missed because I was afraid to ask my boss for the weekend off. Like I was really afraid. And like, you know, 15 years later, I still regret not going to a very good friend of mine's wedding because it was the week after my brother's wedding and I knew she wasn't gonna give me off, my boss. And I just don't wanna be like that. So I now realize that there's a way to always make it work. And like, if someone needs the weekend off, it's a restaurant, like it's gonna survive. And if someone has to work an extra day so that their teammate can get an extra day off and then you make it up to them the next week, like that's all okay. And it really, I think, goes a long way. I think trying to close on big holidays, it seems like such a small thing, but I mean, I sat in orientation at the new restaurant and we were going through the handbook, just like kind of boring stuff. And I just looked at the people's faces when we said we're closed Christmas Eve and Christmas Day, and people like got this sigh of relief. And so I think there are a lot of little things you can do, but kind of going back to all that communication stuff, it's about like really listening to what people are telling you and giving them the chance to talk to you and making sure you're available. And Sean has been really great at this and kind of encouraging me to be like this. He from the very beginning was always sort of like, I'm going to go grab a coffee with whomever. And I was like, what? Like, you're going to grab a coffee with a bartender? Like, that just wasn't done in like me coming up. So I think one of the cool things about Sean is he brings this very different perspective from not having been in the restaurant business for 20 years and sort of saying like, well, yeah, great, it's always been done that way, but who cares? Like, let's do it our own way. And that's been really a positive influence for me.
I feel like there's a lot of growth. I mean, for someone
I've
who's
grown
been quite,
up a little bit. Yes.
For someone who's been quite busy, and I feel like one thing that I don't think a lot of people may realize is this last year has been one of incredible success for you, but also incredible challenge. You were diagnosed with breast cancer.
That is a true story.
Last summer?
Yeah, July 14th, 2017.
And when was your book launched?
I started radiation treatment on September 14th, and my book launch was September 19th. I'm fine, by the way.
Yeah.
Let's put that out there. Yeah. I'm healthy and fine and cancer-free and all that.
But also opened.
Thank you.
But also opened a restaurant exactly a year later.
Yes.
Are you mad?
You know, like life goes on, and I think we had signed a lease, and like it had happened, we had signed a lease, I believe, in March or April of 2017. And I don't know, you have to keep pushing. And I think that, look, when you get cancer, and I learned a tremendous amount during that time. Sort of, first of all, I learned a lot about cancer, because to me, I thought you get cancer and you start chemo the next day. And that's kind of not how it happens at all, luckily. And I think I learned a lot about the process of cancer. But in that time, I also learned, like, it's not a death sentence, and there are treatments. And I was very lucky, and I caught it very, very early. And it wasn't a pleasant thing to go through, and it was very, very scary. And there's a lot of time between getting diagnosed and knowing what your treatment's going to be, which I didn't know that that's how it works. There are biopsies and tests and all this stuff. And I think for me, like, I had a task to do, and I had signed this lease, and I didn't want to let anyone down, and I was healthy enough to be able to still go to meetings, and I definitely adjusted my life quite a bit, and I wasn't at Lilia as much, but I was there almost every night still. I was just there for, you know, 3 hours of service instead of 6 hours of service, and I would go home when I got tired. And I was already sort of on this kick of understanding balance and work, and that had come a lot in my 2 years off of wanting to figure out, like, it was a non-negotiable for me to be able to open a restaurant, and I needed to be able to open a restaurant and still have balance. And I was not good at that at Avoce, and I wasn't willing to do that again. So I set a lot of boundaries for myself, and in kind of getting cancer, I had to reevaluate those boundaries again and say, like, okay, like, I can't be on the schedule anymore. Like, I'm not going to expedite. This is ridiculous. And so I took myself off the schedule. And then once I was done with treatment, I'm like, oh, that's pretty good. I'm not going to put myself back on the schedule.
And you saw that your chefs were
thriving. Sean can expedite.
And because, you know, he's so good at it. And you saw that your chefs were thriving, which I think is an amazing opportunity for them. So there are questions for you from the audience.
Great.
Thank you, guys. There's lots of really good questions. And so we're going to go straight from cancer to another hot button topic, which is, as a female chef, do you encounter gender bias?
My least favorite topic is talking about being a female chef.
So should we just skip that right away?
Look, I've had a very, very thriving career. I've worked for men. I've worked for women. I've worked in kitchens that are all men. I've worked in kitchens that were all women. I've done it all. I say I have not experienced anything bad as a female. I've put my head down, I worked, and I would love it if I could just be known as a chef instead of a female chef.
I think that's
the bottom line for me.
And
I think a bottom line for most women that I know, and I think that a lot of people are afraid to say it, but it's like in interviews, like I literally, before I sign up to do an interview, I mean, I said it to Nilou the other day, I said, I won't talk about being a woman chef.
I don't think she did, otherwise I wouldn't have taken the question.
Oh, really?
But yeah,
say it to everyone else.
Because that's not how
I thought
we
it was just yet. Assumed.
Yeah. So, I feel like, okay, well, because I know design is really important to you, I'm going to skip ahead to the design question.
Yes.
How much do you think design contributes to the experience and success of your business?
Huge. So I think, like, I can't speak to Missy yet because we don't know if it's successful, but Lilia, I'll touch on it. I mean, Lilia, I think the beautiful thing about Lilia is that, for those of you who have been there, I stand in the middle of the restaurant every night. The kitchen was built, so you feel like you're in my home kitchen, and I can talk to you and interact. And I think the coolest thing about Lilia is that every night people come up to me and they say, the food was great, but the service is amazing, the room is so amazing, your music is amazing. And to me, like, I know I can cook, and if I couldn't get that right after 25 years of doing it, then I should definitely go do another profession. But for me to be able to get the whole experience right, the people on our staff, everyone saying they're so nice, the room being warm and lovely, to me, that completes a restaurant. And you can't have great food without the great service, and you can't have great music without a great room, and it all contributes to the experience. And I think we've kind of gotten that with Missy too. I'm getting a lot of comments about how great the room feels, and it's very different from Lilia. It's really modern, and it's in a new building, and I couldn't replicate the charm of Lilia, but I think there's a different kind of warmth that is coming from there.
I'm so happy to talk to you.
Thank you. I'm so happy to talk to you.
Thank you, everyone. We're gonna get off stage.
Thank you.